conversations on social issues. We're so happy to have you here today. I think that many people in this room know who I am, but if you don't, my name is Kimberly T. Malone, and I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here. We have this series every week in the library because we see it as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. So while you may not agree with every single thing we read in the books on our shelves, find in our magazines, or here in this room today, we want everyone to be able to learn and grow from other perspectives. So at the very end of this, I'll ask you to fill out a very brief survey, literally like 5 questions, asking what you liked and what you'd like to see in the future. We want to keep this relevant and interesting to you. So next week, Seattle Central College faculty member Carl Livingston will be presenting Outing the 50-Year Southern Strategy Against People of Darker Color. But today, please join me in welcoming, I'm going to get the names right, Joshua, Anthony, and Andy as they discuss their experiences at Standing Rock and a number of other issues. So please join me in welcoming them.
So I'm Josh. I went out to Standing Rock in February this year. Went from the 17th of February to the night of the 22nd and witnessed the first half of the eviction process, where the National Guard, the County Sheriff, Morgan County Sheriff, and other affiliated agencies evicted 200 remaining protesters from the Chenishikoan camp, which is the main protest camp there, starting since about a year ago now, last May.
Yeah.
Anthony was out there as well. He went out in December, and I actually first sort of honed in on the issue when he told me kind of his story of going out. He sort of snuck off in the night and drove out and went out with one of the vets there. Is everybody here pretty familiar with the Dakota Access Pipeline protest? You guys know? Okay. Yeah, so just in case, 1,172 miles of pipeline extending from the Bakken oil fields in northwest North Dakota, which is a huge shale oil gas deposit extracted with fracking. There's several giant companies, ExxonMobil, other companies that are sort of household names that are cashing in on the resources there. And it extends down to Patoka, Illinois, where it is, you know, lumped into a sort of tank farm and then further processed. This is LaDonna Brable Allard. Her family owns some lands kind of on the northeast border of the Standing Rock Reservation, which straddles the North Dakota and South Dakota border. And the protests started attracting a lot of, there's a lot of youth movements. For those of you who are familiar with it, there's a group of indigenous youth who ran from North Dakota to Washington, D.C. to bring a petition to the federal government to, you know, express their protests against the pipeline. And then as the protests kind of unfolded, things became a little bit more violent. There were a lot of crackdowns against the protesters. And then in September of last year, we started to see the famous images of the water being sprayed on protesters in sub-freezing conditions. You had that 21-year-old girl who lost part of her arm, and depending on whose account you follow, the sheriff's accused her of being near an IED, but witness accounts and live stream video kind of don't really corroborate that. Her and her family have accused the Morton County Sheriff's Department of hitting her with a anti-riot grenade, that kind of thing. It's still under investigation. Then December 4th, the veterans went out. This is when Anthony and Andy went out to show support for the protesters and act as sort of the main mission was to act sort of as human shields in light of what we, you know, what you saw in those images only a couple months beforehand. And then at the same time, there was a hold on the construction of the pipeline temporarily. Under the Obama administration, the Army Corps of Engineers didn't grant an easement to finish construction near Lake Milwaukee, which is a section of the Missouri River, which has its own interesting history if you guys want to look into the damming of the river and the impact that had on the Lakota in the area. But that victory was short-lived. Under the Trump administration, January 24th of this year, he signed an executive order to sort of push through the construction of the pipeline and get oil flowing. So that's kind of what we saw in the lead-up to the eviction, when the Corps of Engineers, the governor of North Dakota, and all those law enforcement agencies ordered the evacuation of the camps. So this is Chenishikoan. This is the main camp. At its height, it was very well established, beautiful, kind of like a, you know, sort of a family atmosphere, a lot of camping, a lot of music all the time, that kind of thing. From what I've heard, people who were back there in August would not recognize at all the things that I was dissatisfied with the camp as I saw it when I went out there. And even when Anthony and Andy were out there, it was snow driven and buried by the time I got out there. It was muddy. Things were being deconstructed. You had a lot of reports in the mainstream media of like lots of trash and things like that. And there was some of that, but it was mostly people trying to clean up and, you know, get their belongings together under a lot of pressure from the government. This is a photo I like. This is a photo from the Bismarck Tribune. When I was out there with my friend Taylor here, we served in a medical group for the day of the eviction. There was a lot of fear that people would get hurt in direct action. We were prepared for the tear gas, rubber bullets, the, you know, things that had historically been used against the protesters. So we sort of self-organized into small groups of people. I'm medically trained, and then there were a couple other folks who were nurses. We had a doctor from Massachusetts who was sort of the de facto leader, but he was really hands-off in terms of like what we'd actually be doing out there. Luckily, none of us had to really do much of anything. The way that the evacuation was organized kind of got everybody geared up for big action to happen, and the cops would kind of come and just stand there and then arrest a couple folks and then wait for everybody to kind of tire out. Go home, which is what happened. The next day, this is actually the day of the evacuation, the day that I was there. I actually ended up leaving this evening to get back in time for classes, and I'd gone out there originally planning to stay for the weekend over President's Day weekend, and got kind of drawn, and I went out with the Veterans Day organization. My uncle is a contact out there, and he's been involved in various ways over the last year or so, and we were going out to establish the Cheyenne River Camp, which is so the Cheyenne River Reservation is just to the south of Standing Rock. And while the Standing Rock Reservation was kind of taking a more hands-off approach and disengaging and trying to confront the pipeline in more of a legal front, the Cheyenne River Tribal Council was still taking a more hands-on approach. The chairman and another group of the folks out there leased some lands from the Standing Rock Reservation and set up a camp that was aimed to be sort of a place of education and prayer, mostly indigenous people from the area with contingent of veterans to keep up camp security, logistical support, that kind of thing. The day of the first day of the evacuation, the 22nd, I believe, a lot of people decided to ceremonially burn structures, some religious structures like sweat lodges and you know, places where people have been praying, places with religious artifacts were ceremonially burned. And like all the headlines that day totally ignored the evacuation and pretty much just talked about how, you know, what Chenishikoan burns was a couple, you know, half dozen structures or so. And I feel like it kind of missed the point. This is what was really going on that day. A huge peaceful evacuation of the camp. Marching under banners, an indigenous-led march out of the camp. The upside-down American flag is kind of a major symbol, sort of a controversial one, but the premise is that hanging that American flag upside down is a signal of distress. And you can see the medicine wheel here, you can't see it completely, but it's north, south, east, and west, and they all have their individual meanings, and that's painted a little flag there. That was before the 2 p.m. deadline that got me back to 4 p.m. and it was you're choosing to leave the camp under peaceful means. And the authorities had like buses and accommodations ready for people who wanted to evacuate. I don't think services, but those folks moved out to the Cheyenne River Camp or back in Standing Rock and found their own way as well. So as the deadline came up, this is the north entrance, the security gate. So they bring the security gate ceremonially and then spread out the concertina wire. There's a flat screen television here in the corner, if you can kind of see it. And it says the, painted on there, it says the revolution will not be televised, which I thought was kind of fun. But yeah. So as the day went on, we sort of fell back behind the Cannonball River Bridge, which is to the south of the camp. I'd gone up to the police line with the medical group I was with, and we asked if we could stay as medical support because they didn't have on hand ambulances or anything like that staged. So we thought we might give it a shot and see if we couldn't stick around. And we also kind of asked on behalf of some of the journalists that were up on the road if they would be targeted specifically. And they said everybody on the road and in the camps was subject to arrest after 2 p.m. that day. So we fell back and hiked over the bluffs to the south of the camp into the Cheyenne River Camp and ended up leaving that night. This is this gentleman here, the far right of the group of three, his name is Eric Holmes. And he was live streaming and confronting the police line. And then moments later, they chased after him and tackled him. Initially, he thought he'd broken his hip, or broken his leg, actually. And then updated everybody on Facebook that he had broken his hip. And that's still controversial. Not everybody, you know. Depending on who you ask, you'll get different sides of the story, which is the same thing. It's just true for everything about this thing. This is the next day. National Guard rolling in, Humvees, Bearcats, excavation equipment to tear down structures in the camp. This guy here in the lounge chair, his name is Jasper. He was the sort of our house dad for the last night for the medical group I was with. He set up the camp for us and was a pretty cool guy, pretty involved in the camps for a really long time. The same day, there's a helicopter overhead. This is a border protection customs helicopter with a sniper in the window.
Ooh.
Yeah. And like a constant presence in the camps, or a constant presence in the camps was the sort of small fixed wing aircraft circling over all the time. I usually get a helicopter. It's kind of weird adjusting to it in the first couple days coming back home. Like every time you hear a plane overhead, it just kind of like spooks you a little bit. But it was a lot different for somebody who was there only a week. We talked to some of the folks who were there for months at a time, and it's just like a kind of a trigger for them now. So this is a group that stayed for the last day, the veterans response guys. They were a little bit more action-oriented than the veteran stand guys, who were more like logistical support. These guys all kind of got ceremonially arrested. And then the gal here with the Navy flag, that's Regina Brave. She was a Navy veteran, excuse me, and a Native American woman from the Standing Rock tribe who was arrested that day. And that's her. She was also involved in the occupation of Wounded Knee back in the 70s. So very.
Why is she being arrested?
Just for being there. Yeah, she refused to evacuate the camp with everybody else. This is the 23rd when the National Guard pulled in. And so all the folks in this picture, most of them, as far as I know, ended up getting arrested. So yeah, that's it for my first-hand experience. Drove back that night. Anything you guys wanted to
try to
look at those in my poster?
Yeah, of course.
Look at the deployment in this assembly.
Well,
but if you want to go through sort of right along here.
I mean, I'll set the ground for it. We can picture that. So, a little background story. I went out there as well as Andy separately, we didn't do it at a time, for the special respond to Standing Rock movement in November. Andy? About the date?
Thank you.
You went to December.
December, yeah.
December 4th.
I'm about the date, so I apologize for that one. When I went out there, I got there, actually the day of evening when it was announced, which was a hell of a moment to be out there. A large part of what I got there was doing just providing medical support. I am an LPN currently, so just helping people out, because there was a massive, there was a massive influx of people that came in there all at once, and I don't think anyone's really kind of that many bodies flowing in. It's a lot to hook up with. Let's see. Got out there the day of the easement, worked as a medical setup, and now I'm going to hand it off to Andy. See you later. Yeah, I don't like talking to my groups. Thank you.
Cheers.
All right.
So what Rory was kind of saying was basically September when the video started surfacing of water detectors being attacked by water cannons and rubber bullets and tear gas and sites of anti-aircraft missile launcher and 203 grenade launchers. It kind of really disturbed me that the people that I swore to defend were being attacked by the state for redressing their violations of their safety and happiness. And personally for me, I didn't feel like I served people when I was in the military. I felt like I was being used as a tool for the corporate establishment. And felt really demoralized when I got back out of the military. And when I saw this happening, and there was a call for veterans to come out and defend people, it was kind of like the first time I felt like I was going to have to go out and serve. And so the call came out in November. Four veterans and the original organizers said they'd be okay with 50, and all of a sudden you saw 11,500 total vets signed up through the website ready to go out and defend people. Well, they could only afford 2,000 of us to get on buses and kind of Standing Rock. So I was one that was chosen, and this is the first time I pulled out my gear after 3 years in the military. And it kind of just kind of what I wrote here, what we've been doing for the last 500 years to Indigenous people is immoral, and I just couldn't sit idle, especially my son being Indigenous himself, and his future being legislated by special interests. So I decided I wanted to go out. So I unpacked, got a tattoo, and that's me and my son. Waiting out in the parking lot by King Street Station, ready to go on the bus. So we arrived, we checked in, kind of put up the tombs. This is the chow hall. That's the first leg of the Washington bus group. The total of 110 vets from Washington State went out between two different buses. This was Fort Yates, where we were having to sleep in a high school gymnasium on the floor. There's the Bureau of Indian Affairs following us, and we eventually got pulled over. And mine. Here's the line going into the camp. Started about 6 in the morning and went all the way to about 2 o'clock in the morning. Vets started driving in from all over the country. We had a total of about 6,500 vets coming in on the day that we were all coming in on December 5th. Here's some of that. This is Rosebud Camp. Prayer circle that went around the entire Roadway camp. Here's a photo of some bureaucrats showing up for a photo op and leaving right before the blizzard hit. You had Tulsi Gabbard show up, and then you had Cornel West show up, and they're in for a year, and then they just kind of left us. Here is the Ocheti camp entering. Here's the barracks that veterans were putting up to house those that were coming in. here's my tent. I was, our bus drivers were ditched and left to sleep on the bus because the DAVL bought up all the hotel rooms and there was no room. We were promised empty tents that were left by the Colorado group, but when we showed up, there was no heating system set up. There was no ground, like stable ground for us to sleep on. There was nothing. So there's 13 of us from Washington State that were just ditched at the camp and had to kind of figure out on our own. And the rest of the Washington State vets got lucky and jumped on the bus with the bus driver and just kind of left. You know, one of the main issues was we had no real communication system set up, no radios, no, I mean, we were relying off cell phones that had Verizon service. I mean, I was communication, tactical communication from the military, and we didn't even have a stable talk set up. So I didn't have a real job when I got
set talk.
Tactical operations. So. some community cooking, you know, we all kind of came together. It was sort of like a commune, everyone sharing their resources and just kind of, you know, being there with each other. And one of the most beautiful things that I experienced there was the camaraderie, something that I haven't felt since almost like basic training. I forgot what this building was called.
It
was a big dome.
I helped take that down. Yeah.
Not stop panic.
Yeah, there's the fireworks going off over the police line up on the Turtle Hill, maybe?
Yeah.
The night that the one with
the 90s.
Celebration on the night. Here was a snow panther that some people built. Here's our camp that I was sleeping in, a new camp that was built called Blood Camp, which is essentially just veterans on the front line, closest to the front line. And then when the weather started getting really bad and the police obviously had barricades up and we had no way of getting supplies through, it got to the point where we were running low on firewood and kind of had to consolidate with each other. So I ended up moving my tent because the next morning I woke up, two-thirds of my tent above was covered in snow. And I was freezing and didn't know what to do. So we put up a veteran medic tent, and you can't really see it, but we were just stacked up next to each other, trying to stay warm. Yeah, so keeping heaters burning. This is the signal, what they call the signal hill.
Yeah, Facebook Hill,
Media
Hill. Hill.
Media Hill was the only place where you could get some type of access to signal. Indigenous Environmental Network. And here's us preparing on the front lines. We did have insiders that were. Infiltrating our buses in groups, and one guy who claimed to be a Marine ended up, we found out he was not and disappeared right after this, somehow convinced all of the veterans about to go on the front lines to drop their gas masks, their shields, etc. And we just basically went to the front line completely unprepared almost. And that's marching to the front line. There's myself. Was kind of it. So I mean, we deployed on the. I went out December 2nd, got there December 4th, and was there until December 7th. To the point where I was personally getting scared because there was no resources to get out of the camp or home, and I caught a ride in the last car leaving the camp and just kind of knocked on the window and said, "Hey, you went to the airport." And that was the last time I was at the camp. But it became a metaphor for something bigger that we did swear to defend the people, and I don't see an expiration of that oath. But right now, the people's liberties and abilities of
I've been following this diplomatic pipeline when I saw it on Democracy Now, you know, where Amy Goodman was there, and, you know, the security guard had, you know, unleashed dogs on, you know, all the protesters. I it's really inspiring, you know, just to see all the veterans go there and support, you know, people and the Standing Rock tribe. I have a question about the role of Army Corps of Engineers. So how come, you know, like back when Obama was president, you know, they were like, oh, we need impeachment, and you know, like we need to do more, you know, groundwork in figuring out if it's safe or not. And then all of a sudden, you know, you hear that, oh, the new president, you know, has ordered them to, you know, and like, why, like, how can they comply? And, you know, like, are they legally, you know, obliged to comply to a president's, you know, decision?
100%. When you're in the military, your boss, no matter what happens, is the president. That is the final word for any orders you ever get. So as soon as our current president came out and said, this is going to happen, it pretty much, you don't have a choice. They're going to deny it any further because their boss said, no, we're doing this.
Did that answer your question?
There were police officers that consciously objected and did not go to the camp. But as far as I know, I don't know of any Army engineers or certain group that refused orders.
There were a couple stories mentioned here and there, but there's always hearsay.
Yeah.
There was no official no, because that's a good prison forever. So that's called treason.
Or a disarmament.
What the Army Corps of Engineers could have done, they could have made it into a civil matter.
Into a what?
A civil matter
of
the state. Because you got a civil engineer that could have came out and said, okay, it's unsafe.
And I would get that.
Right. But even still, it's like a catch-22, because then the president could order the Army Corps of Engineers to come back and override him. But I don't think he would have been that smart to do that.
Yeah, but we already have the governor saying that he signed an order to do it. So he would have sent a civil engineer, and then the governor would have overrided before the president had to do it.
I was wondering if you could talk about how it's a very powerful experience, you know, which I believe you guys must have all felt being there, and you know, how it changed you while you were there, and you know, now that when you look back at it, you know, what, you know, just like, you know, how your feelings have changed over, you know, this time.
Oh yeah,
for
sure, I'll answer this one first. It had a pretty profound impact on me. I mean, I should mention this beforehand, but the reason I went out there in the first place is I was doing a research paper on for English 102. And I had a free weekend and some friends who were willing to kind of split the cost and go out, and I had a contact on the camps, and everything just kind of serendipitously lined up in such a way that I could manage to go out there. And I felt like I ended up doing a lot of good. I definitely feel like I have a much better understanding of what, I mean, I have friends who are vets, and I have friends who, you know, have kind of experienced the process with being a veteran in, you know, the USA and being a veteran in, you know, the full scope of history in the United States, and how much of a challenge that has been for them. But I didn't quite understand. When I was out there, I met a lot of service members who were from a lot of different eras, going all the way back to Vietnam, all branches of the military, and all of them said exactly what Andy had said. They felt it was a continuity of their oath as soldiers and as Marines and airmen and as citizens of the United States. So that, I think that was an interesting takeaway, just to see how profoundly committed these people were to following that mission. And then for me personally, it was, I don't know, I'm very ambivalent about the whole thing. In some ways I came at like the most depressing point of the protest, fairly hopeless situation. I felt like I did what I could to, you know, being one person and something like that, have a positive impact. But it was still, I mean, you come away with it feeling a little bit helpless, and a little bit disillusioned, disenfranchised, whatever you want to call it. But I did end up, before that I was interested in doing something in medicine. Now I'm much more interested in journalism and social issues and things like that. Veterans issues, of course. So for me, that's for me personally.
So for me, it renewed that oath. It basically helped me, it reminded me to continue fulfilling that oath by defending all peoples from all forms of oppression. Like I said, one of the things I missed when I got out was the camaraderie, that sense of driven purpose. My job specifically didn't translate completely when I got out of the military. There were still a lot of certifications that were not accepted by the civilian world, and I felt demoralized, a discarded tool almost, and I've been lost and completely separated from veterans and the community. And like you said, there were veterans from all walks of life on those buses. I'm in 21 to 81, disabled to able, angry to peaceful, and it was beautiful. You know, I felt like this is what I wanted to do. It was the reason why I joined the military, was because I wanted to serve people. And I didn't get that feeling during my 6 years in the career. And so, even though I didn't get to do my job out in Standing Rock, I found other areas where I could serve. You know, I was filling generators and helping disabled get out of the camp, or shoveling snow, or, you know, just something. So it helped me through my PTSD. One of the groups called Veteran Respond, their mission is healing through service. So that's kind of what it did me. It helped me bring, it brought me back in one big circle to my battle buddies. So I miss my tribe.
So what was the ultimate goal of all the vets coming together, going there? What were you guys' ultimate goal? What were you trying to accomplish?
But the primary mission was to go and serve as a shield from brutal attacks from the state, or attacks that were coming down from the state. And then what it ended up becoming was a commune. And then we were there to just, you know, like you were saying, we were doing logistics, we were doing environmental impact, you know, studies, we were doing talks set up. I mean, we just started doing our jobs like we did in the military.
Yeah. Everybody felt like it didn't matter who they were, what they were doing.
There was no real hierarchy. You know, we just kind of knew where we belong. You know, medics over here in medic tents, you know, comms over here in the talk, you know, engineers, barracks, and etc. We also had some fun. You know, the night that I got there, I went out with a small group. And I don't care if you dox me, but we were cutting down razor wire and we were confiscating canoes that were taken by Mormon County Police. And, you know, just saying we're not here for bullshit and games. So quit attacking the people that we swore to defend. That was simple. That was the mission. That's what I got out of it.
Yeah. Oh, please. Sorry.
Oh, I was just gonna ask, kind of. I was thinking a lot, like you were saying, it's real easy to kind of fall back into like old kind of habits and jobs and how you communicate with each other. You know, my husband's a vet, and I've gone and done some volunteering with him with like Veterans Conservation Corps and Mission Continues and some things like that, and it's always amazed me how groups of people who have served in like very different eras and different branches of the military really do have that language to communicate with each other and just know how to work together. So knowing that you guys can really fall back into that system a little bit and be just this like really efficient machine that just kind of takes over a project really easily, because you're good at working together like that, how did you try and kind of balance that with like knowing that you're coming into kind of what's a fight that you can relate to, but kind of someone else's fight? Like, it's really about the indigenous people who live there, and it's their livelihood, their land. Like, how do you try and find a balance between making sure that their voice was really supported, as well as, you know, finding some of your own voice and your own experience there?
Well, for me personally, working with the Veterans Stand Group, a lot of that was done at the direct request of the Cheyenne River Camp. So, which is run by the authority of the chairman of the Cheyenne River Tribe. So I I personally felt pretty comfortable about not having my own, you know, life issues and ties to the protest override the goals of the camp itself. But it was something that you had to be like constantly aware of, not making it, you know, it's everybody's fight, but it's not, you know, these are the people who are going to be impacted directly if there's an oil spill, and these are the people who are having their treaty rights violated. I was going to say real quick, that's another big takeaway for me. I mean, everybody learns in school like the Trail of Tears and things like that, but unless you really dig into it, it's not exactly clear how, you know, it wasn't just Andrew Jackson, it wasn't just, you know, the Cowboys and the Western expansion. It was a systematic process of, you know, displacing people who have, you know, worked and lived on the land for.
Call it what it was. It was a genocide.
Yeah, it was a genocide.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, it was very systematic. I didn't have the you know, historical basis and the firsthand basis that I do now to talk about that. And I met a lot of folks out there who would, you know, there was a woman I went to a meeting of sort of the grandmothers of the reservation, and they talked about, you know, growing up and having to leave their land because it got flooded out by the dam, and, you know, going to Alcatraz Island and doing occupations with the American Indian movement in the 60s and 70s, and, you know, this is a living history for these people. They're still feeling the impact, and I wasn't quite, I mean, I kind of knew it, but now it's like, now I can talk about it's there.
And from knowing about it, from reading the book, and from knowing about it, from talking to someone who's actually
yeah,
experience.
Exactly.
It's kind of like, if you go, there's a documentary we watched in Moore, when I was telling you about my Moore philosophy, it's called Race, the Illusion, Power of Illusion, and how it all started with Thomas Jefferson and the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal, but yet you got Indians who are up here because they're brown and they were white, and the blacks always down at the bottom of the list. And they talk about it, the history of racism and the things how the U.S. took, even with the Louisiana Purchase, how we invaded that and took from Mexico, the Philippines, and so on and so on and so on and so on. And they're still doing that today, in this case, with this pipe. People always say, well, it's racism, you know, racism never gonna go away because it's always gonna be there. Each time you take something from another group of people, whether it be jobs, money, whatever, you're discriminating against that group of people and their culture. So that age-old question, is race gonna go away? Never. Can we make it go away? Is there a solution? Maybe we got a woman president.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of that. Just kind of learning how to be an ally, and how to support something without co-opting it. It's kind of a complicated line to walk, but if you just listen when people are telling you their problems. That's applied day to day, of course. But like, you gotta listen and make it about, you know, the people who are suffering, not yourself.
Yeah. Don't tell press groups essentially how to address their oppression.
Yeah.
So this is a question more specifically for Josh, but because you were there, I know, like right at the very end.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of us, you know, kind of focused on this issue really once it became this protest camp, and a lot of people weren't paying attention when it was just like more of a debate early on. They formed this camp, people started focusing on it, and now that the camp is disbanded, a lot of that tension has gone away, but
right.
You know, having been there at the end and really talked to people as they were evacuating, what's your takeaway for like how people are addressing this or not going forward now that the camp is disbanded and as we kind of start fighting other issues around the country, like up in Alaska, they just start trying to open up more drilling again.
Yeah.
And I know there's some resistance with like the Tidal tribes up there.
Well, I think for one, Ochetti Camp in particular was a great sort of a paragon, a little bit, a really good example to follow as to how you can sort of organize effectively, and you know, draw attention to issues there are a lot of occupation camps springing up in light of the renewed construction on the Keystone XL pipeline. The Veterans Stand Group now is known as the Veterans Service Corps. They're pulled up in Eagle Butte in South Dakota, which is where the Dakota Access, or the Keystone XL pipeline, I should say, is going to pass through near tribal land in South Dakota. So they're working to fight that. So yeah, I think it's, and another thing I should add, a lot of the protesters who were at the camps themselves are going back to their home communities and have been really galvanized by this, and you're gonna see them, you know, taking part directly in these other fights in Alaska and North Dakota, other places around the country.
Okay, one of the next fights the current fight's happening right now is on the KXL pipeline. I don't know if you've heard, but next week on Monday, or last week, there was a call to shut down Chase Banks, which is the main funder of the KXL pipeline, and Veteran Respond is partnering up with the Water Protector Contingency, and the rally will be at 11 o'clock in the morning. So if y'all are interested in shutting down some Chase Banks next week.
Yeah, there are people who came from all over the country, all over the world, and they're bringing it back to their home. You see it here in Seattle with the city divesting from Wells Fargo. You see it in D.C. with the march that happened there on March 10th this year. A lot of people came out on the mall, and some of the vets I was with shut down at SunTrust Bank, which is one of the big investors that chained themselves up at the entrance. And got cussed out by the manager, sped off in there, kind of left him there. But yeah, so I think, like I said, it's going to be, it has been sort of a galvanizing moment, but it's also, you know, couple that with how demoralizing the end was. I think a lot of people came away with it feeling kind of depressed, and, you know, as people sort of recover from what they saw there, maybe we'll see kind of a, you know, a little bit of an upswing. And I know myself, it was, you know, it was a really hard thing to witness. It's affected me and the people who went out with me. And I think one way to cope with that is to continue to, you know, use what you learn and, you know, struggle onwards in the same vein against the same issues. I don't know, what do you guys think?
Yeah, keep the momentum going.
Yeah.
I mean, we have 110 vets that left Washington State. The ones I've stayed in contact with are about 20 to 25. Because a lot of them feel like they were just left behind, demoralized. One of the biggest, one of the largest issues that we have is one of the main organizers named Wesley Carter Jr., who had himself camped up in a casino hotel, and there was no real good line of communication with him. You know, he wanted to come out every once in a while for, you know, a press conference or to walk around the camp. But other than that, we had issues where a bus was flipped over with 20 vets. He had come out to help. It was 10 miles away in a blizzard. You know, Washington State vets were given 3 empty giant tents. You know, it was just, there were real no support from the original organizers.
You know, there's a lot of issue with. Oh, go ahead.
Do you think protesting is more effective than a legislative prospect?
Why not do one or the other? Why not both? I can vote and the protest can happen.
Diversity of tactics.
Yeah.
I mean, that's all this country.
You're just saying you're paying more money for that.
I don't think. I bet that you have the same one.
Yeah, so I think my personal opinion is that the legislation is only going to move forward once, you know, other ends to resist protest are exhausted. When you have thousands of people banging on your door and calling your office, you kind of have to do something about it. I think legislation is always going to be kind of a compromise, too. So you'll get part of what you ask for, but not all of it. Or it'll look like you're getting what you're asking for, and won't actually be that at all. So I think people being, you know, self-educating, self-mobilizing, and you know, active and effective, that's where you're going to see the most impact. Even if that impact ends up coming from legislation, it comes from the people first.
We're actually protesting, you know, in this nation dates back to when we declared independence. You know, the reason why we have weekends is protesting. The reason why we have 8-hour work days is because of protesting. You know, when the Bonus Army, after World War I, went to D.C. and had, you know, contact with police officers for their payouts, there is a history, especially with veterans. There's always been a long history of veterans supporting working class struggles. So it does work.
So social media was like a huge part of camp cohesiveness and making sure everybody was on the same page in terms of like information, watching rumors, sometimes perpetuating rumors, but it's kind of a double-edged sword. There is still this page called Digital Smoke Signals, which I encourage you guys to look up on Facebook. This guy who runs the page. Dewey, what was this?
No idea.
Do you remember? That's okay. So he had a small fleet of drones that he would operate and go surveil the construction of the pipeline. He would do overwatch of the camp and kind of update people on a sort of three times a day basis as to what was going on in the camp. We have that's just one example out of 15 dozen or so pages that are just as dedicated, just as effective. So social media was a huge part of that. And then in terms of like what we did in front of the camp, what's that?
A lot of space.
Yeah.
A lot of space.
A lot of cars.
That's nothing new.
Yeah.
That's military.
Yeah, it's
all good.
Come
on. I gotta have a snowball fight or something.
A lot of it was just working to survive. In terms of the things that I guess I would sort of call fun. Having opportunities to learn from indigenous leaders, the elders there, going to talks. There's a lot of peer education and meetings and self-organizing. And I guess by some definitions, that's pretty fun. But a lot of singing, a lot of praying, prayerful, peaceful organization, that kind of thing. And I know some of the younger folks who've been there for a long time and go out and harass the security guards. Up the pipeline, they had snowmobiles that would work in the mud, so they'd take those up there. And I guess as far as what you can call fun in the camps, from time to time we'd go to the casino and talk in the bar and share stories. A lot of the vets would share like war stories or like how they ended up involved in the protest or how they get screamed by the VA, that kind of thing. It's mostly just having each other. That was the fun part.
Like you said, most of the time we spent was just to figure out how we were going to survive out there. And working constantly, it was fine. There was the night out machines and intimidating the police.
I think it's just about time to wrap up here, Kimberly.
So I want to thank all of our presenters for joining.
Thank you, Mr. Shaver.
I'm going to ask how big we're going to have.